Thank you, Governor. So we're about ready to get started with our program. I do have a couple of housekeeping notes I want to run through before we begin. First, I want to recognize or have the opportunity to have some of the folks who play an integral part in our fish and game management in terms of the policy arena, and that would be our Game and Fish Commissioners. And I know several of them are here in the audience, and I just ask that they stand and be recognized for their hard work. I guess. Thank you. I know also, at least in the pre-registration, several of our state and locally elected leaders are present today, and I want to thank you for your sacrifice and your public service in the roles that you play. We have, when you do an event like this, we're out looking for sponsors to help defray the costs of that are associated with this, and we have several very generous sponsors here. Pheasants Forever is probably our major sponsor, and I want to thank them for all that they're doing. They have all of their habitat biologists in South Dakota present, and we'll hear a little bit later from Dave Knobson, one of their chief staff folks, and he'll be making a presentation. And I know at least one of their national board members from South Dakota is in the audience. I think he's in the back row there, Tim Kessler. Milbourne Seeds, the South Dakota Retailers Association, the Truax Company, the South Dakota Municipal League, and South Dakota Parks and Wildlife Foundation were all generous cash sponsors of this event, and I want to thank them for their generosity and support. I also want to thank especially all of the landowners who are in our audience today. I want to thank you for being here. We all know that South Dakota is a private land state. Certainly 80% of our state is privately owned. And we know and recognize and appreciate that you provide most of the habitat that pheasants and other wildlife rely on to try and make a living. And we look forward to a constructive discussion today on ways to maintain and improve that habitat. So again, landowners, thank you for coming out, and thank you for what you do for wildlife. Just a quick note, the South Dakota Public Broadcasting Network is broadcasting this session live this morning. It could be found on the internet, streaming live, and then the tape of this will be made available through their website, and I think we plan to also provide a link to it on the Game, Fish, and Parks website. So be on your best behavior this morning because you're on camera. We have staff on hand to help with any questions you might have. We're going to be shuffling folks to different breakout rooms later, and I'll talk a little bit more about that when the time comes. But anybody you see out there with one of these orange name tags is working with us to try and help keep this flowing smoothly. Those are staff from Game, Fish, and Parks, from our Department of Agriculture, our Department of Tourism, and some of the Pheasant Forever staff as well. At the end of the session today, we have a special gift for all of you who attended, which is a book, it's a monograph that was published about a year ago on the ringneck pheasant here in South Dakota. We'd sure like, as you leave the room, we'll have folks in the back handing those out. Please grab one of those books as a token of our appreciation for you taking time to be here. So the last thing, two more things. We don't have any designated breaks if you look at the agenda this morning, so we're going to continue to move through the program without any formal breaks. We understand that for some of us that's a kind of a long period of time, and if you need to get up and stretch your legs or use a restroom, restrooms are off to the sides. I think you can access them through the back. So just do that on your own. There won't be any breaks, and just want to make sure you understand this is a fairly informal setting. We ask you to pay attention, but at the same time understand needs as folks, at least at my age, have. We will have a limited time for a question and answer of the panelists, so we won't be doing questions as we go. Our State Department Secretary of Agriculture, Lucas Lentz, will be up here, and he'll moderate that session. So as we're going through the process, if you look in the portfolio that you were handed, there is a 3x5 card or two. If somebody says something and that strikes you and you have a question about that, take a minute at that time and write your question down on that 3x5 card. We will, as we rotate through speakers, we'll have staff available. Just hold your arm up with that card, and we'll pick those up, and we'll provide that information to Secretary Lentz, and those questions will then get asked of our panelists as we go through the Q&A time. So that's about all I have for housekeeping at this time. So with that, I'd like to introduce our first speaker. Tony Leif is our current Wildlife Division Director in South Dakota. Tony began his career with the department in 1987 as a conservation officer based in Freeman. He worked as a wildlife biologist and senior wildlife biologist in Huron for 16 years as the department's lead on upland game. Tony moved to Pierre in 2004 as the program, as the Wildlife Program Administrator, and he directed statewide management and research of game animal populations. Tony's a graduate of the Huron High School. He earned a degree in wildlife and fishery science from South Dakota State University here in Brookings and a master's degree in wildlife science from Texas Tech University. Tony and his wife, Candy, have four children. We're not really sure how Tony ended up down in Texas, but we are glad that he's back here in South Dakota doing a good job for us. So please welcome Tony Leif.
Thank you, Jeff, and thank all of you for being here today. It's a great day to get together and talk about something that's very important to, I know, a lot of you. Let's see if I can... Top one? There we go. My job here this morning is to talk a little bit about the history and put a little bit of perspective around pheasants and pheasant management in South Dakota. We believe this is really important to set the stage for what you're going to do this afternoon, and that's to spend a little time helping us chart the future of pheasants and pheasant hunting in South Dakota. So let's start out and let's talk a little bit about this amazing bird, and it truly is an amazing game bird. If you look past at the past 10 years, we have harvested, on average, 1.8 million pheasants in this state. It's kind of bounced around between 1.5 million and 2 million, but on average, 1.8 million pheasants harvested annually in South Dakota. Now, when I was back working with pheasants, one of the most intriguing things that I found is we're not actually an entire state of pheasant hunting opportunity. Reality is the bulk of our opportunity is located in the eastern half of South Dakota. That would be all those East River counties plus Lyman, Tripp, and Gregory counties. 95% of our pheasant harvest occurs in the eastern half of our state, and that'd be about an average of 1.7 million over the past 10 years. Opening weekend, I don't need to tell all of you what opening weekend of the pheasant season means to South Dakota. It's a huge event for hunters and non-hunters alike, rivaling other major holidays in this state. On a typical opening weekend, we harvest about 360,000 pheasants over the past 10 years. That'd be about 20% of our total harvest. And then over the course of the subsequent 7 days, combined with that opening weekend, that's about half of our harvest that we get for the entire season. And again, that average of the past 10 years is being on the order of 900,000 pheasants. We've had 95 pheasant seasons in South Dakota. And over the course of those 95 pheasant seasons, here's one of the most amazing numbers to me. We've harvested 138 million pheasants in South Dakota over the past 95 years. We'll talk a little bit more about how that distributed across those 95 years as I go through these slides. Here's another thing that I think is key. South Dakota is the perfect place for the perfect game bird. Everything aligns just right in South Dakota as far as the weather conditions and the habitat conditions when you look at a place for this bird to prosper. It's an ideal mix of grasslands and cropland. Landscape dominated by either one of these in singularity does not produce the pheasants that it does when both of these grassland and cropland acres are combined on a landscape. It's a hardy bird. For all of you that came in this morning, that doesn't come as any surprise that we need to have a bird that is extremely hardy for it to succeed in this state. It's highly productive. I've had a chance to study a number of different game birds as I was going through graduate school and as I was in early years in my career with the department. And there's no bird that's as productive as this, as a hen pheasant. They're tenacious nesters. They'll nest over and over and over in a summer if they are unsuccessful. If they lose those nests, they're right back at it. They put a lot of eggs in that nest, and they are tenacious brood rearers once they do hatch those eggs. And here's a neat thing that's about pheasants that's unique among lots of our game birds, is that you can tell the males from the females, and their breeding system is such that you only need a few males for breeding. So there's never a fear of over-harvesting, or that fear is very, very remote. And allows it, again, to be the perfect game bird, an ideal game bird. Now, there isn't going to be a test today, but if there was a test, this is the only thing that I would have on it, because this is the most important message I want to convey to you this morning, is that two factors control the number of pheasants that we have in South Dakota. And I'm going to start at the bottom of these two factors, and Secretary Vonk did allude to these also. The first of those is weather. We are going to fluctuate year to year based on the various weather conditions that we have. Now, whether we're going to fluctuate at a level of 10 million pheasants on the landscape, or whether we're going to fluctuate around a mean of 5 million pheasants on the landscape, depends on habitat. So we're going to take a look at this, and we're going to see that in the slides as we go through those, that you're going to see that there are trends in the graphs of the history of pheasants in the state, where they're in a general population level, but things are bouncing around due to weather. The other important point that you need to keep in mind as we're going through this morning and on into the afternoon session is together that habitat and weather influence populations through two factors: the number of birds that you enter into that population, the reproduction, the nesting and brood rearing, and secondly, how many of those birds survive. And habitat and weather together determine how many birds survive and how many birds will be produced. And the last and very important point that needs to be made is there is a very strong link between agriculture and habitat. I had a supervisor and a mentor who I know is in the audience here today who stressed this to me my early years, and nothing could be more true in South Dakota in particular, that nothing will impact pheasants more than agriculture and the agricultural practices on the landscape. So let's talk a little bit about this bird. It is a bird from a different continent, and I think most of you know that pheasants are not native to South Dakota, and there are actually 35 different species of pheasants around the world. They're native to much of Asia, and they actually were brought into Europe, in particular into England, by the Romans during the reign of the Roman Empire. They were extremely fascinated by this bird and wanted to spread it around as they ruled the world at that point. Many years later, pheasants came to Oregon in the Willamette Valley, and that introduction of pheasants occurred in 1882. So let's talk a little bit about how these pheasants then got to South Dakota. The first documented attempt, to release pheasants in South Dakota was in Minnehaha County, when a Dr. Zetlitz of Sioux Falls had two males and four female ringneck pheasants shipped to South Dakota from Illinois. That was in 1898. Dr. Zetlitz didn't release those birds, but rather he put those in a pen and was able to hatch about two dozen pheasants the following year. He released 10 of those birds in Minnehaha County at the junction of Split Rock and Sioux Rivers. History books tell us that those birds did persist for a while, but ultimately they all did die out. The origin of pheasants, and it's almost suiting that we are here in Huron, very close to the location where pheasants first got their stronghold in South Dakota. It was in 1908 when Mr. A.E. Cooper and E.L. Ebert had several pairs of ringnets shipped from Pennsylvania. Now, what Mr. Cooper and Ebert did was they released those birds right away in 1908. There was a very tough winter immediately following that, and as near as they could tell, none of those birds survived that first winter, but they didn't give up. In 1909, they had a few dozen wild birds shipped in and released those birds south of Dolan. There is, the history books say there's uncertainty whether those birds actually came from Chinese heritage or if they actually came from England. But these are the origin of pheasants in South Dakota, just a little bit north and east of here, up in Spink County. After these birds, it was apparent that they were going to be successful in establishing populations. Our agency back then got together with the Redfield Chamber of Commerce, and they worked with a number of different Spink County landowners to trap and transfer pheasants around Spink County. Also, right here in Huron, a couple years later, State Game Warden Bancroft displayed 200 pairs at the South Dakota State Fair. And a rooster and three hens were issued to farmers that lived along the James River for them to take those back and introduce those birds and help this bird spread. Now, one thing I've also learned about pheasants is they're not real great pioneers. I mean, they aren't going to spread out long distances and develop into areas that they aren't already there. So this act of trap and transfer was a very, very important key. And as we look at some of the slides of how pheasant hunting developed in the state, you'll see how quickly these birds spread. And that had to have been due to a lot of these efforts of trapping and transplanting those birds around the state. First pheasant season in South Dakota was in Spink County in 1919. It was a one-day season with a simple bag limit of two birds. Records are sketchy, of course, but the best we could tell is there were about 200 roosters that were harvested during that first day. Now the next year, 1920, the season went to 2 days, and the bag limit stayed the same, but number of hunters went up, participation went up, and we had an estimated harvest of 1,000 roosters. In 1921, things are starting to spread. Now, once again, you can see this season that the open area is right along the James River, and that seems to coincide with, again, that part of history that tells us these birds were given to landowners along the James River, believing that that was some of the most ideal habitat. As I was putting this together, I looked at this slide and I said, okay, you had a three-day season, then there's a day off, and then there was 2 days, and then a day off, then another day, another day. That's how they decided to set up the season back in those days. But I got to just, you know, with the internet available, I hopped on, I thought, well, what days were these? And it happened to be the week of Thanksgiving. So in 1921, that first season, or the first 3 days of the season, was in Spink County, and it ran Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday before Thanksgiving. November 24th was Thanksgiving, that day was off, and then Friday and Saturday after that, right here in Beetle County, there was a two-day season. And then Sunday was another day when the season wasn't open, and then it opened again on Monday and Tuesday on down into San Warren County and then into Davison and Hanson counties. 1922, again, just 1 year later, you can see how things have spread. And once again, I think there were 20, this season was 20 days long, although it was never longer than 3 days in any one of these counties. Now, when we finally get to 1923, we get to finally a point where we have a primary range and a secondary range of where the season is running, which is more the typical format that we see throughout the rest of the history of these hunting seasons. But it was a six-day season, and it was pretty apparent that pheasants were here to stay and that pheasants were going to be a strong part of the South Dakota culture. So let's jump ahead 5 years. We're to a point now where most of eastern South Dakota is open to hunting. The season's 40 days long, a liberal bag limit of 5 pheasants per hunter per day, and even one of those could be a hen back then. This was a monumentous year in that our resident hunters hit the plateau of 100,000 hunters. Now, also in your portfolio, you have a card in there that's a legal size sheet that's folded in half that has a lot of these statistics on it. And if you get the chance, take a look, because that's one of those interesting historical facts that we wanted to make sure that you had as you're working through the day here. So if we jump forward to 1931, and the only reason I put this one up here is because this was a monumentous year, and that was the first year that the daily season, or the first season, opened up at noon. Now, I've had a lot of people ask me over the years, what is that? Why is this thing at noon? And the best answer is that it's steeped in tradition. And as you can imagine, a tradition that began over 80 years ago is one that's pretty well ingrained in our society. But in 1931 was the first year that the opening shooting hours started at noon. Couple slides we'll go through quick here. 1932, you can see how things expand, where all of eastern South Dakota and most of western South Dakota is open. 1933, we have all but 4 counties open. Those 4 counties, Lawrence, Stanley, Lyman, and Brule. And I find this a bit ironic, too, because 2 of the strongest counties where we consistently have the highest brood counts are Lyman and Brule counties, yet they were the 2 of the last 4 counties to be opened up to pheasant hunting, which was 1934. So 15 years later, after the first pheasant season in South Dakota, the entire state of South Dakota is open to pheasant hunting. Now, we're gonna hear a lot more later today about some of the things, or the interrelationship between agriculture and pheasants. But it's important to point out that, you know, to think a little bit about what was happening back in history, and I've done a little research in preparation for today, and I think all of you probably remember the 30s were we were in a depression in this country. There was extremely dry periods that a lot of land went idle that had previously been under production, and that provided a lot of habitat for pheasants. But weather, again, was playing a role here. And in fact, some very difficult winters that I was reading about in the late 30s ended up resulting in a reduction in the number of pheasants. And there were some pretty drastic reductions in the area of the state that was open to pheasant hunting. Now, as we move forward into history, of course, 1939 is when the world started to go to war. It was a couple years later before the United States was drawn into that war. But there was an initial attempt or thought that the United States was gonna have to play a key role in feeding soldiers and feeding the world. And so there was a push to bring more land under production. Well, as I read the history, I learned while that attempt started, in the end, it resulted in a lot of land going idle that was previously under production because of a shortage of steel, because of the requirements of the war, and also a shortage of labor. So by the time World War II was wrapping up, we got to some of the highest pheasant populations ever documented in South Dakota. The season in 1943 actually had 2 parts to it. This is the fall season. It started on September 25th and throughout most of the state, ran all the way through the end of the year. Bag limit was very liberal, 7 pheasants, of which 3 could be hens. And you can see that there were another 8 different units throughout South Dakota. But that wasn't it. The season continued on through 1944, when another 60 days, so altogether, the maximum number of days hunting for 1943 and 44 was 159 days. This continued for a couple more years, as you can see here. In 1944-45, the season was the longest it's ever been in the state at 163 days. And then in 1945 on into 1946, again 153 days. Now, as our soldiers came home from war, labor again was available, and we saw a lot of those fields that were previously idled went back into production. And again, that did have an impact on the number of the amount of habitat that was on the landscape, and had a effect on the number of pheasants that were on the landscape. So let's look at those first three decades. If you can see, as we start here back in the first season in 1919 and move forward, how quickly pheasant numbers grew, stabilized through the 1920s to 1930s. Again, there's that long-term trend we're talking about. That one dip that you see in 1937, that was primarily a reaction to some tough weather conditions. And it was probably less of a factor in pheasant numbers as it was the pheasant season itself. A highly restrictive season, only a couple days long, only allowed for the harvest of a few thousand birds. And then you see this other area in our history where we peaked out at an all-time high of 7.5 million pheasants harvested in 1945. When you have that many hunters coming to the state, or that many pheasants being harvested, you obviously had to have a lot of pheasant hunters. And that post-war boom, there was a lot of excitement around pheasants and pheasant huntings, and a lot of people flocked to South Dakota. In 1945, there were 87,000 non-residents that came to hunt in South Dakota, and in 1946, there were 84,000 non-residents. Not only was South Dakota noted as being a great place to hunt pheasants, it also was an excellent place for non-residents to come and hunt waterfowl, too. In 1947, the legislature actually banned non-residents for hunting the first 10 days of the hunting season. And in addition, they banned non-residents from hunting waterfowl at all. They were entirely banned from the state then. This had a pretty substantial impact on the number of hunters, obviously, that came to the state if they couldn't hunt for those first 10 days. Only 13,000 of them showed up in 1947. And only 26,000 came in 1948. Subsequent to that, it was just in 1949 when the legislature reversed that ban on allowing hunters to come in for those first 10 days. The ban on waterfowl license remained in effect. I'm not sure what year, but it was many years later before that ban was finally removed, and some non-resident waterfowl hunters were allowed to come back into the state. So let's look at the second 30 years that we had from 1950 to 1980. Let's look at first the 1950s. You can see that there's a pretty stable trend of somewhere between a million and 2 million pheasants being harvested. Still good harvest at that point. And then the late 50s and early 60s, there was a different habitat trend on the landscape that dictated a higher level of pheasants that we were going to fluctuate around. And I think many of you would recognize this time period as the soil bank days. These were the days when the birth of what we know today as a CRP program, although it was a much different program back then, contracts were much shorter. They were as short as only 3 years long. And it was a short-lived program. It only lasted from the late 50s into the early 60s. Then you can see we were back down fluctuating at pheasant harvests that were at most around a million pheasants, and dipped as low as 300,000 or 400,000 here in 1975 and 1976. Secretary Vonk did mention to you that there was a group that formed back in that time, and there was a lot of concern because of the low harvest of pheasants that was occurring back in the mid-70s that this South Dakota Pheasant Congress was formed. It was formed in 1975 at this time period when pheasant numbers were quite low. It was made up of over 150 organizations. What came out of the Pheasant Congress was the authorization or a change in state statute that authorized the sale of a $5 pheasant restoration stamp. That was in 1977. The monies that were generated from the sale of this stamp were put towards habitat. The majority of those funds went towards habitat. And the focus was nesting habitat. And this was the basis that we learned from the soil bank days, is we knew when we put that grassland cover out there, left it idled, it was a highly productive place for pheasants to nest and raise young. At its peak, the state program of nesting habitat on private land reached a peak of 25,000 acres. So when you put that into perspective, it did have some ability to enhance local pheasant numbers, but it really fell short of having a large statewide impact on pheasants and pheasant hunting in the state. Then along came the Conservation Reserve Program. It was a part of the 1985 Farm Bill. Unlike the old days of the soil bank, these contracts were much longer. They were 10 to 15 years in length. And it converted cropland into this idle grassland. As we learned from soil bank, as we learned from the pheasant restoration program, this was key in producing strong pheasant numbers in South Dakota. There are also multiple benefits that were intended with the CRP program of 1985, besides the primary goal when it was initiated was to reduce production and improve prices of commodity crops. But the multiple environmental benefits that came along with it include reduced soil erosion, improved water quality, and most notable here today is the wildlife habitat. It was a place that produced nesting and brood rearing areas, plus year-round habitat for pheasants, and it did have an impact on statewide pheasant numbers. So as I said, there was a state program that was much like CRP. So when CRP came along, Game Fish and Parks modified the program, and this was about the time that I came in to work for this agency, and I actually have had the opportunity to work directly with this program. First thing that happened was the 1975 Act was amended in 1988, and the $5 pheasant restoration stamp became a habitat stamp, and the fee was raised to $8. The program, the state program, was redesigned to establish habitats that complemented the grassland habitat that came with CRP, most notably winter habitat, winter cover in the form of woody cover, and food plots. This also was the time period of the birthplace of our new private land access program, which has been copied and established in many other states since then. Of course, this is the walk-in area program. So let's look at the pheasant harvest under this third three-decade period of 1980 through 2010. You'll see those early years of the 80s, we're probably averaging around 1 million pheasants harvested per year. Still good. I mean, South Dakota was still one of the best places to hunt pheasants. But then as you see that CRP come into play, you'll see the gradual incline that we have, the general incline. Of course, the population is still bouncing around based upon various habitat conditions. But when you put this graph up against the CRP enrollments, you have to scratch your head for a minute and say, now wait a minute. Our largest CRP enrollments were in the 90s, and our pheasant population doesn't seem to follow it really well. And there's a good explanation for that. This graph shows you the pre-season population, so we've shifted now from talking about harvest, this is actually pheasant population numbers, and comparing that with the number of acres that were enrolled in these land retirement programs. The peak you'll see back there in the 60s, of course, the pheasant numbers followed very closely to the increase in the number of acres that were out there on the landscape. But again, the early 90s, you would say, why wouldn't we have had a few more pheasants in response to that habitat that was established? This had to do with where exactly those acres were actually enrolled. Early in the life of CRP, and in the late 80s up through 90s, you'll see that a lot of the enrollment in CRP, the darkest brown on this map, was out in western South Dakota. I think most of you are familiar enough to know that the primary pheasant range of South Dakota is probably in and around this oval that the red oval that's on your screen. So in 1990, we did have a lot of acres, but the overlap with where our primary pheasant range wasn't there. So in the 1995 Farm Bill, there were some revisions that linked CRP enrollments with wetlands. And a lot of South Dakota farmers took advantage of that new CRP program and enrolled a lot of acres, more so in this area where we have, where our primary pheasant range is in the state. And here is where we peaked. Our second peak was actually in 2007, and this was also the year that we had our highest modern day population and our highest modern day harvest of pheasants. So let's look at that graph again. As you see, those acres that were back in the 90s were shifted towards the eastern part of the state where we have pheasants and it overlapped with our pheasant range, a much more pronounced impact of that habitat being out there where we have our pheasants. So where do we go from here? We're going to spend a little bit more time later today with some other folks who are going to focus on this link between agriculture and pheasants, and then look forward to this afternoon for your time and your contributions to help us figure out where we're going to go from here. Are we going to fluctuate around a mean of 1 million pheasants? Are we going to fluctuate around a mean of 1.5 million pheasants? It all depends on that all-important habitat, and I want to make sure that you know how much that I, the department, appreciate you being here today to help us figure out how we're going to get to that next place over the course of the next decade. Thank you very much.